So now that we've cast all the steering wheels we need for our Carnival ride rebuild, I need to paint them. And last year when I cast the first four samples, I sent them out to a friend in Indiana who powder coated them for me. But now that I have 16 more to do, I don't really want to overextend my welcome with him. So I need to paint them myself. And I love the powder coat finish. It leaves a really durable finish. It looks really good. But I kind of don't like the process. It seems kind of messy. It seems like more powder ends up on the floor and in the filters of the paint booth than you actually get on the part. And I started to see some videos where people were dipping parts in these churning vats of powder. And with a little research, I learned that it's called a fluidized bed. Of the examples I've seen a bunch of really small examples where people are dipping fishing jigs in small little PVC containers they made. Or I saw these big industrial applications where they're dipping huge gates and things like that. But I haven't seen many examples where people are dipping parts of this size. So I'm going to try to design a fluidized bed that I can use to dip these steering wheels. So my idea here is to create a 3D printed cylinder with a chamber at the bottom, which will release air into the powder through a number of evenly spaced holes. This part is going to max out my Ender 3 printer's capabilities, almost completely filling the print bed. So I've had really good luck 3D printing over the years, and I've never had a nozzle clog until last night while trying to print this. And fortunately, I caught it right when it happened. I tried to recover, I tried to pull the filament and see if I could get it flowing again. I could not, so I just shut it down. Definitely clogged there. I'm going to turn it on and heat it up. I suspect it's probably degradation of this PTFE tubing. Well, it wasn't a simple fix. We've got it all torn apart. The PTFE tube is stuck in the heat break, so we're putting a new heat break in, new nozzle in, and then we'll reassemble it. I've got a new PTFE tube we can use, and we'll be back in operation. All right, time to see if we can recover. I've been letting this heat up here. It's 95 inside the chamber, and I have created a new version of the program that starts at 3 millimeters, which is where we left off.
Okay.
This machine has been running for years without any maintenance, really, and I think we just had a bunch of little issues. It'll be great if this works, because that was about 4 hours of work right there just to print that.
Well, it looks to me like we salvaged this.
All right, well, I recovered from the clog, but the part itself failed. We ended up warping pretty severely, and I think it's a combination of two things. I tried to print it in ABS plastic, and even with my heated build chamber, it's still warped, and I think that's due in part to the geometry of the part. Everything was going fine up until this upper layer started to print in here, and I believe when it printed, it contracted, and it pulled the whole part in on itself and folded it up. So I have hope that this idea is still going to work. I'm going to try to print it out of a different type of plastic. We're going to go with PLA, which is much less susceptible to warping, and see if we can get a good part. We're going to use a coffee filter in the bottom to prevent the powder from filling up the lower chamber, so I need to create a ring to hold the filter in place.
Definitely going to need to let this cool down, I believe.
So this is our 3D printed part, and I've got the filter in there too. I need to try to glue this tubing in. I don't expect it'll stick, but just hoping it closes up the gap a little bit. You can see signs that even with the PLA, the top of the chamber area pulled in a little bit and created a visible line on the outside of the print, but not enough to cause the print to fail. Here is our powder we have ordered. Prismatic powder, alloy silver. Now, does it fluidize is the question. Plug in our little pump here. This is just a little aquarium pump.
That's not good.
I think we have to go back to the drawing board.
We're not getting an even distribution. Gonna have to think about that for a little bit.
Think.
It's working good where it's working. Great in here, it's working great. That works really good over there. This might be a case of us having too much powder in here for the amount of air we have. Or I may just need to redesign the air grid.
So I'm going to change a few things. First, I'm going to make it a little bit smaller. Secondly, I'm going to print this in three separate pieces. That'll allow me to optimize the printing orientation for each part. I'm also going to add more holes in the plate for the air to pass through. And finally, I don't think we're getting the maximum flow possible out of our pump by only using one port on the manifold, so I'm going to add more air inlets.
Okay, we're getting some leakage here around the base, but I think a couple screws around the ring will hold that in place and we won't have that anymore. But the bigger issue is we're still not getting even distribution of the air. Close but no cigar. And I've got an idea how to fix this.
So while I was doing the research for this project, I came across an old Mark Rober video from about 7 years ago where he was trying to create a fluidized bed, and in the video he mentioned having 25 different failed attempts before he came across something that actually worked. So I don't feel too bad about this project here. My next attempt is going to be to take the base and divide it into different chambers where I can individually adjust the air to each part of the chamber and see if that gives us a little better performance.
All right, so printing another base. I have great hope for this version. It's about noon right now on Super Bowl Sunday, so by my estimation, by the time the Super Bowl is over, this print will be finished.
I started to have some problems with the blue filament, so I switched it out for this red midstream.
9 hours and 21 minutes.
The following day.
So I'm just running this pin vise through all these holes, and I think there's 360 some of them. So this will take a while. I just want to ensure that all these holes are the same size. It's kind of therapeutic just doing this. I haven't even fully tested this one yet, and I've already got another one printing on the 3D printer with some improvements I want to make. So on this current design, I've got four air tubes feeding four different zones inside this base. But that requires all these air lines to run all over the place. So I've designed a new version that doesn't do that. The new version of this is going to have six different zones, so it'll be able to use all of the positions on the manifold. That's a nice tool, though. I just got that. Came with a selection of little bits, and which I now need to clean up. I think this was only like $9, and it helps feed an orphan. Coffee filter. Now, I need to put screws in here to hold this down. I probably shouldn't have put the pin vise away. Let's try with just that amount. So this should just be the center. Yeah, it's kind of leaking. And I think we're gonna need my next revision to get this working the way I want it to. This doesn't have a perimeter of holes all the way out to the edge. The new one will.
So another new and hopefully final design. As I mentioned, I'm dividing this into six zones, and they're all going to feed from the same side. I should note that these zones are all calculated so that each zone has the same amount of surface area and roughly the same amount of holes. I'm running a few more rows of holes closer to the perimeter. I'm also going to make the outer cylinder a little bit smaller so it's a tighter fit against the filter paper.
The latest version 5 hours and 34 minutes. And there we go. 10 hours and 52 minutes.
This blue filament's been sitting for a long time. I really hope it doesn't break.
Overall, this is a pretty boring print. It's literally just a cylinder. Nothing special happens till you get to the very top.
You can see that little ridge there. That's where we had a power failure. Had to resume. Right where that loop is.
All right, there's our last piece, and I have no idea how long it took because we had the power failure.
All right, I'm very hopeful that this is our last iteration of this.
I am thoroughly gluing every wall perimeter in an effort to prevent as much leakage between chambers as possible.
Okay, we just need to put some weight on it now. I think that looks pretty good. We'll let that cure overnight. I was a little nervous putting all that glue on there, hoping it didn't start to set up before I got the thing together. And our manifold will feed right into there. We should be able to individually adjust the areas. We're going to have some bleed over from area to area, but I think it's going to be good enough.
Early the next morning.
So our glue has set up overnight, and we're ready for the next step on this. This is going to get a coffee filter over it. And one of the problems with the coffee filter is that the air is going to collect underneath of it and counteract all the work we did of dividing this into separate areas. So my idea here to counteract that is I'm going to give this a coat of spray adhesive, and I'm going to glue the coffee filter down with the idea that the spray adhesive isn't going to go into the holes. It's just going to glue the filter down, and cross our fingers it's going to work. And we're just going to spray this. I'm going to go away, not get it all over my workbench. And this is our new ring. This ring is a little bit tighter. We ended up with some problems with the last ring where we kind of had some gapping. So I took this in a little bit. So now the question is, will it work the way I want it to? Okay. Last thing I gotta do is just put a couple screws in this to hold it together. Just like the last one. I think we'll try with that. We might have to add a few more screws. That's the center. Ideally, you want the air to lift the powder enough to make it float. When you get these plumes of powder, it's called channeling, and that's not really what we're going for. It's quite a balancing act trying to get the right amount of air for the powder.
We can do more powder. See if we can dial back our pressure a little bit here. I think that's going to work.
So how are we going to make this work when we don't have the electrostatic charge that would normally be part of the powder coating process? Well, a look at those industrial applications from earlier lends us a clue. They preheat the part. In this case, we aren't heating it to the curing temperature, just enough to get the powder to gel on the surface of the part and then knock off the excess. Then it goes back in the oven to run it up to the full curing temperature. So I fabricobbled together a rack that'll hold the steering wheel in the oven for me. Assuming this works out, I want to build a bigger oven. I'm looking around for an old electric smoker or something that I can convert into an oven. But until that time, we'll use what we've got. Additionally, I've done a little bit of sanding and filling to smooth out the wheels. The last time we powder coated, we discovered that JB Weld holds up to the temperatures of powder coating, so it can be used as a high temperature bondo for filling imperfections. Off camera, I also printed an extension ring, just to give me a slightly higher barrier and keep more of the powder in the bed when it decides to channel and spout. Well, enough talking about it. Let's just do it. All right, first thing we're going to do is put this in the oven and run it up to about 250 degrees. I created a little hook there that I can hang those horizontally. That should get it to the right temperature to cause the powder to gel. Just doing a little check of the temperature here. Starting to look pretty consistent. So I think we're going to take this out of the oven. And back in the oven. Now we'll run this up to the curing temperature. So this powder coat needs to be baked at 400 degrees for 10 minutes. So it's not in the oven for 10 minutes. It means that the surface temperature has to get up to 400 degrees for 10 minutes. And with this small oven, it seems like it usually takes about 10 minutes to get up to temperature, and then the next 10 minutes to actually bake at that temperature. So a 20-minute cycle usually does it. All right, I think we're good here. I'm going to pull this out. I am pretty happy with that finish. We'll just leave it here to cool for the night. Well, I think that turned out pretty good, and I will leave links down below in the video description to all the tools I used, and if you happen to be interested in the 3D files, I'll leave links to them as well. I've done a few more wheels, but truth be told, I'd love to be further along. I hurt my left elbow back in January, and I've been doctoring it ever since. Even though I'm right-handed, it makes things like prepping and sanding these wheels really difficult. So I've got an appointment with an orthopedic specialist tomorrow, and I hope to get some answers and get back to 100% as soon as possible. If you'd like to help support this project, consider jumping on Patreon, like preservation level patron David McNaughton. Or if you just want to follow along, click that link to the left and come along for the ride.
We're going to go through all this work for this thing. We might as well print a lid for it.